Let's tune.
Give me an E. Give me a B. Give me a D. Give me a D. Give me an A.
Howdy. Good morning, everybody. And welcome to my second instructional video. And before we get started with any new stuff, I want to fix a few mistakes that I made on my last instructional video. They're not like blatant, raging, huge mistakes, but just things that I found a lot of people have seemed to overlook, probably because I didn't really explain them well enough. About a good 99.9% of the last video was all based on this kind of thing, the old 3-note per string. Kind of like picking, you know, alternate picking string with a downstroke. Kind of thing. Millions of variations on that, and it's all based on being able to do that lick, you know, cleanly and with some amount of control. But one thing that is pretty easy to forget, or must be because I've seen a bunch of people doing it, is forgetting about things like dynamics and control of the general tone of the string. By that I mean like being able to mute it when you want to, or being able to have it open. And by dynamics, being able to play it real light and mute it if you want, or real open and loud. And the basic way to practice this is just by doing that exact thing. A clean tone helps. I mean, if you turn down your volume a little bit and get like a twangy kind of clean tone, you can hear it a lot better. So initially, just try that lick. That, but do it real quiet and muted, and try to do it at a tempo where it's pretty quick, you know, that you're comfortable with, something like. Then try the same thing, but hit it real hard and don't mute it. And then try to go between the two different feels. You know, if you can play it quicker, great, you know. But this takes a lot more control than just hitting everything with the same attack and the same volume. And this will really help you to give it a more musical, you know, just put it in context musically better in any way you play it in a song or in an unaccompanied solo. It'll give you a lot more control. It's a lot more expressive that way. With distortion, it'll sound a little bit more like this. Let me try it like this. I'll hit it real light and muted first. Start hitting it harder. Light and muted. Now, if you're not comfortable with this lick yet, or any, you know, picking, fast picking things, just try it with maybe a single note. Take like an A note on the D string or something, and just practice playing that in one note, real lightly and real muted and quiet, and then get real loud with it. You know, you can take any tempo you want, maybe start off with something like, and get louder, not faster, but louder. Now the actual technique for this, isn't necessarily hitting it much harder with a pick, but using more of the pick to hit it, which ends up hitting the string harder. In other words, I'm sort of lowering my my pick into the string. When I'm picking it lightly, I'm still picking it pretty hard, but you're just using the very tip of the pick, you know. And then I lower the pick in to hit it harder because it uses a larger part of the pick, so it whacks it a little bit better, you know. That's how, even when you pick lightly, you're still picking pretty hard, but you're only using a little teeny part of the end of the pick, so it still has a lot of control, but it has the kind of dynamics that you want, the kind of dynamic control that you want. And it's a really, really good exercise to control that. You know, again, try to do a lot of different tempos. Maybe start out with something slow like that, and then if you can, with practice, start to speed it up, you know. A lot of different things. Another thing is accenting, being able to accent certain notes sort of on purpose. A great way of practicing that is, again, the same kind of idea. Maybe you could take a number, a very musical number like 8, and accent, you know, play 8 notes and accent the first one. So go like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the 1 is always accented, and the other ones are quieter, you know. And again, that's, you know, pretty slow tempo, all alternate picking. try speeding it up a little bit. Again, it takes a lot more control than just hitting, you know, just doing straight, sort of non-dynamic version of it, or not accented. You can also practice that by reversing the stroke, starting with an upstroke instead. A little bit harder. Upstrokes just tend to be a little bit harder. It's a great exercise, and it sort of gives you a speed limit on your whole picking. You know, you'll never get any simpler than just playing one note and picking it. So you know that if you start doing things where you go to other strings, you know, or doing string skipping or whatever, it's going to be a lot more complicated, and chances are it's going to have to be slower than anything you do. So in other words, you know, see how quick you can get with and control everything on one note, and then you have that as sort of your speed limit for other licks. Again, an example of that, if you can do this, it means that you're going to probably not have too much trouble doing something a little more complex that's the same picking speed. But you're not going to be able to exceed that, you know. That's the first thing. And one more thing before we get to the terror death licks. One more thing about dynamics. When you're working on a lot of these faster licks and a lot of things that require real, real, very precise technique, you tend to sort of have your right and left hands be doing these very accurate things and moving real perfectly and everything, which is great for that sort of thing. Try not to forget there's a lot of guitar feels that are really cool that are a lot looser and have a lot less efficient but still cool moves. Like, for instance, you can just take three notes, like something like that, G, A, C, A. And if you did it, you know, the old precise method with very little picking motion, sounds something like that. But a lot of times, you know, in a rock context, it sounds really cool if you actually, you know, get your arm pretty far up and really whack. That's the thing. You almost get a percussive kind of sound from the lower strings. You got to make sure that you have them sort of blocked out so they don't go. You know, so don't do that. You can use your thumb on your left hand or the palm of your hand on your right. And when you hit all those strings, you get that whack that really sounds cool. You know. You can also hit open strings if they're in the right key. Like, you can kind of strum. That's a Jimi Hendrix thing he used to do a lot, where he'd sort of strum a note and play along with it, doing simple melodies, but it would sound real intense, which is a lot more exciting feel than, the efficient way. So there's a lot of different ways. You know, don't put yourself into a rut where you always pick everything with the same dynamics. You know, be aware that there's other things where you can really whack it if you want to and get a lot of different feels. You may not be able to play as fast, but it'll give you a whole different emotional impact on you, your audience, your mom, you know, whoever.
We want a good time, we want a blast. Come on, follow, don't you be fast.
Okay, it seems like everybody wants to know some incredibly fast picking licks, and this is one of my favorites. It has sort of an ambiguous timing to it. It basically just came out of some pull-offs that I was doing, and I tried to pick them, and they seemed to work great, but I found this works best unaccompanied, unless you do a lot of songs in 9/8 or some time signature that few would dare to play. But this is basically how it goes. It's all on two strings, the B string and the E string, and it's all in G minor. And I'm just going to play through it real, real slow. That's basically the first pattern of it. From there, it just does the same kind of pattern, but starting on that new note. So that from there it would go. From there. From there. And then I ascend the same thing. and you're back at your original note. So let me play through the whole thing without stopping so you can hear how it sounds together. Like that. Now, before you even attempt doing this quick, it's really important to just sort of take one section and get it down. So you probably want to start at the top and just go, you get that much of it. All alternate picking, starting with the downstroke. And the thing that really keeps me on the ball doing this is concentrating on where the left hand shifts positions, and for some reason it always ends up being a downstroke there. So if I sync up, my left hand shifts and my downstroke seems to help a lot. So I concentrate on going down, down, because those are the two shifts. Down, down. And I found that that really keeps me in sync with my two hands. So let me play the whole thing pretty quick and see if it works. Here's the same thing. Let me try out with a little more distortion and the treble pickup to get that mean sound. Here are some pentatonic licks that are two notes per string, but they're still fast. This is sort of a 16th note feel in A minor pentatonic, and it sounds something like this. Let me see if I can get through it. And basically what I'm doing is this kind of pattern where got an A note on the D string, and I descend three notes in A minor pentatonic, that kind of thing, using the pull-off to make it easier to pick, basically, and then I ascend back up to the original note, and go up to the C note and back down. So the way I sort of look at it is these two things. This is the first part, and this is the second part. So it's A, G, E, think about them notes, and G, A, C. So the two parts together. That's the main sort of meat and potatoes. In fact, that'll give you a real good kind of triplet lick. Slower. Sped up. And then all I did to make it a 16th note feel is add two more notes on the end that we've already played a million times, so it shouldn't be too much trouble. And then I added on A and G, just descending again on the same scale. So I'm repeating a lot of notes, but it ends up sounding cool. That's the whole lick. And just that, cycled over and over, will sound pretty cool, you know. Again, check out the accents. That's a real important thing. All I did was put that on each set of three strings in the pentatonic scale. So I'd start the first one maybe on the A string and do that pattern. On those three strings, keeping within the shape of A minor pentatonic. Then do the one based on the D string. This is the one we started on. Then do one on the G string, which happens to be the D note. Some kind of pattern, a little bit slower. and some kind of thing based off the B string. We play it all together so it makes some kind of sense. It's the first one, second one, third one, fourth one. Maybe end it with a bend. And you put it all together. Here's a variation of the same thing. Basically, we've already done this. It sounds like this. It's that triplet one, which I sped up about 2 minutes ago. And you can do that same process of using that lick on each set of three strings. You know, so you start again on the E note, and then do the same thing on the A note, on the D note, and on the G note. So altogether it's going to sound like this. Next part, next set of strings, and a B string, and end with the bend if you want or something. And play a little quicker altogether. Try it again with some distortion. One of my favorite, you know, sequences there.
Hey, Paul, how about a bluesy version of that?
Here's yet another version of that kind of thing. This one has the blues note added, which is the flat five. And sinister sounding if used the right way. The fingering is a little bit different. On this one, I'm up in seventh position, and the basic notes we're using are those that half step apart there. Be, I guess, E flat and D sharp, or wait a minute, E flat is D sharp, E flat and D. And you've got a three note stretch on the D string and the A string. The notes would be C, A, and G, E. So the whole thing. That's your shape. The pattern, real similar to the stuff we've been doing, where the first part goes, you know, that's the same thing as, but different set of strings, or I mean, slightly higher on the neck, but still pentatonic. Then at the end, I put in this little sequence. I go, descend one, two, three, four, five notes in the scale, and then end it with a little descending three on the end. So real slow, that sounds like, that's the part that goes on the end. So the whole thing together, it's going to sound like this. One more time. And if you hit that hard, mute it, and play it a little bit quicker, it sounds really cool. Something like...
about some arpeggios.
Okay, I know there's a bunch of arpeggio meisters out there, and this one hopefully will give you what you need to do some arpeggios that will sound cool. I went through a lot of different sort of techniques personally with arpeggios, a lot of sweep picking stuff, a lot of string skipping, and just different ways of doing them. And I found that, for me, the string skipping stuff really works great because it's easy to keep in a solid tempo, and it's easy to do different phrases with it. Let me give you an example of an exercise I worked out. I hate using the word exercise, but it Yes, I've used it as a warm-up, but it sounds cool, too. It's a musical thing. It's based off this one lick, which, if you saw the last video, you've seen this lick. It's in D major. All I'm doing is two notes on the high E string, F sharp and D. Two notes on the G string, which would be A and F sharp. So right there you get a string skip. You're not using the B string at all, you're skipping over it. Don't play it, it'll sound bad if you do. Yeah. The lowest note is D with your second finger on the D string. 12th fret, D major. There it is. The picking for this, I don't know, it's kind of weird. For me, it's always been easy because it's just three downstrokes, down, down, down. A lot of people just have trouble with it initially, so I've metronomed it a bunch, try to get it down so it feels comfortable because it sounds pretty cool. Then all I do is ascend with using those same notes. Back up to the top. For that, I do two upstrokes and a bunch of hammer-ons and pull-offs. So the whole thing sounds like that. Now, right there, you can do a lot of variations, you know, like... Right there is one that... with sweep picking, that'd be quite a hassle.
That was quite a hassle.
Or you can get more complex intervals and jumping around with this sort of thing. Let me slow that one down a little bit. Pretty cool. So obviously a lot of different stuff you can do with this technique if you screw around with it enough. Back to the exercise. This is, again, using that D major thing, which I'm sure you're sick of hearing by now. So you're ready to go to the A major version. It's relatively simple to play because it's the same lick, just on a different set of strings. Same lick, different set of strings. And the way I go between those, I descend, go back up as far as the D note and go way, way down to the A note on the A string, 12th fret. So it's going to sound like... So you got a pretty big shift there. Oops. Take two. Between those two notes. Before I would do this, I'd practice that section a whole lot to get that transition down. Then when you get to the A, same lick as we just did, but a different set of strings. That kind of idea. So the whole thing together. That's the first part of it. Then we have B minor and F sharp minor. Slower. Those are like this. It's a slightly different pattern. You've got a minor shape instead of a major shape, so you got to alter it a little bit. It's got a minor third stretch between D and B, and a major third stretch between F sharp and D, and a low B note. And again, that same exact shape, lower set of strings for the F sharp. The F sharp minor triad, that is. So that one, again, same pattern where you go all the way down and back up to the B, and then hit the low F sharp. So it sounds like... And again, you can practice that one picking thing between the two, between that real big string skip. Pretty big skip. And if you put that together with the first part, last one. Oops, sorry, wrong key. It's in G. There we go. The last one. It's in G major and D major. And this should be pretty easy to play because it's identical to the D and the A one. Same shape. But down in third position. So the whole thing so far. Then I go back up to G major, which we've already played. And A major. So the whole thing real slow. That kind of thing. Let me see if I can get it up to tempo. Ascending thing in E minor. And the basic pattern starts with the D note with your pinky. And whole pattern, like each section sort of sounds like this. So it's sort of down three notes and up. I don't know, let's count and find out. One, two, three. It's like, it ends up being about six notes. One, two, three, four, five, six. So down three, up six. And then up one more with a slide with your pinky. To the next note in the scale. In this case, C minor, so from G to A. And right there, I start the pattern over because the first pattern started with your pinky. I start this one with my pinky also. And when you connect it, it'd be whole thing together. Same thing descending, although for the descending version, I start with my first finger on the A note and ascend, just everything's backwards. I start, instead of descending, I ascend three notes, and instead of ascending six, I descend six. So it sounds like something like that. Instead of sliding up, I slide down. So that's the basic pattern for descending. Oops. That all together slow. Quicker. And still a little bit quicker if I can do it.
We're in a trance, we're in a daze. Come on, Paul, show us how to phrase.
And here it is, ladies and gentlemen, my new method of practicing. Metronomes are history, the whole thing's in the garbage. This is the new hip thing. Which I came up with while we were on the road with, or while I was on the road with my band, we had this one riff that basically at the end of the song I'd play the riff and I'd have a little, you know, a couple bars of the riff and a couple bars of a solo. And I'd always improvise it. And I started practicing backstage and warming up, just doing just that thing where I play the riff and then play the solo, something like this. And I try to keep the tempo with the solo. So it'd be like 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. And I just found that it made my phrasing work so much better. It forced me to play a lot more in time than I do when I'm just sitting around noodling. Even though those licks can be cool, they don't really define a rhythmic structure as much as when you're trying to really keep the rhythm with the solo. And it just made me a lot more aware of what's going on rhythmically. When you don't use a metronome or a drum machine or a drummer or something that's keeping time, and you have to keep time with the solo, it makes you play a whole different way than if you have a drummer or something like it to fall back on. So I'd find that it tended to slow my playing down a bit, and just the phrasing gets so much better. Let me do a little bit more of that so you can see what I mean. Again, I'm doing this part is the rhythm. It'd be like 1, 2, 3. In the solo. Rhythm. Solo. It was also a great way to work in my fast licks into a context that worked in a band musically in real life. So, you know, for instance, if I had some fast thing, I could try to work that in. I'd have to figure out a way to get in it, into it, and out of it within that short period of bars. So let me see if I can do that. 1, 2, 3. Okay, and like that, I'd want to fix it, maybe have not quite as abrupt an ending. Maybe 2, 3, 4. I gotta have an ending that doesn't suck, so 2, 3. You know, and it really helps you to just get used to going in and out of things. Let me do that with a couple more licks so you can see what I mean. I'll do it with a string skipping thing. Very similar to something we did earlier. It's 2, 3. And anytime I lose my little foot tap there, I know that I've got to work on it. And it just gives you a very definite goal of what to do with your licks. You have a tempo, you have a key, you have a groove. And to me, it's a lot more fun practicing that way than, you know, here's a lick with a metronome, I really don't know what I'm going to do with it, you know, kind of attitude, which is what I did for a long time. But, you know, stuff was terrifying enough where I still kept some interest in it. But this works great. A lot of fun practicing this way. And I do it a lot of different grooves. And in fact, you know, try these at home. Here's a real simple one in A, just, you know, 4 kind of feel. You know, painfully simple, but a lot of fun when you trade off with a solo thing. And you can do anything from real simple stuff to real terrifying stuff. The trick is fitting it in so it keeps the time. 2, 3, 4. Thank you. anytime that you screw up, you know, you can stop and try to fix that lick. So the next time you do it, you can get out of it. Like that one, I had a little thing at the end. So it'd be a... So I'd like to have a better note. One more time, so I can get it. Pretty soon, you know, everything you play just starts having a real logical beginning and ending, and you sort of develop your phrasing intuition that way. And you won't believe it how cool it works. Let me give you one more example. This one, again, similar thing in E, but more of a shuffle, like 1, 2, 3, 4, that kind of thing. And let's try it. Let's try this a little longer. Let's give it a few more bars in the last one of rhythm and then solo. 2, 3, 4. Another thing that it does that really helps your phrasing out a lot is if you do any one groove for, you know, over a minute or two, if you're anything like me, you start playing the same licks over and over again, you know, the ones you're comfortable with that work for this, and it really inspires you to come up with new stuff for that groove. I find a lot of times I'll start off things the same way and end them the same way, and after a while I start thinking, what else can I do? There's got to be other ways of ending and beginning licks. And really gives you a lot of useful just phrasing tools. And let's go to another groove, you know, just try all these, you know, at home with you know, if they're real hard, initially try them with a metronome, just keep yourself in. But best thing is to, you know, you just use your foot and try to keep it in time with your guitar playing, you know, have that be the metronome.
I understand completely.
So you've tried some of those things with rhythm solo. And soloing isn't working. What do you do? Here's some like specific things you can try to think rhythmically instead of just all note-wise. A thing that I really try to do is to be able to analyze anything you hear into a purely rhythmic form. In other words, if you hear like 2, 3, 4. If you hear that, be able to hear it as 2, 3, 4. You know, pure rhythm. Like anything you hear, be able to think of it as if it were played on a snare drum. Be able to do it with vocal lines, horn lines, guitar lines. And just whenever you hear music, try to hear it only rhythmically. And this will help you so much when you build your own melodies or phrases, because you can sort of do it the other way around. You can take a simple rhythm, add notes to it, and you won't believe how cool it'll sound. I mean, you can take things that are pretty goofy sounding rhythms. I mean, again, let's take that groove, that in A, we have this tempo, and just take a real simple rhythm, something like maybe 2, 3, 4. You know, and then add notes to it, like 2, 3, 4. And you have a cool phrase immediately that has an interesting rhythm to it. Obviously, it has to have one because that's what you started with. You can start doing more things with a rhythm, like, let's see, same kind of thing. You know, and that's... So that's sort of the process. I mean, eventually you want to get to the point where you can play the notes and the rhythm together, but it's a great place to start with just the rhythm, to be able to break it down to that level of simplicity. And the more you analyze music that you like, I mean, make sure you pick stuff that you dig. You know, take copy tunes or, you know, start with that. figure out what the vocals are doing rhythmically. It's usually really, really simple. And but with all the other stuff added on, with the melody and with the phrasing, with the dynamics, and with the tone, it ends up sounding cool in the big musical stew. But it all starts with the rhythm, or at least that's one place you can start. It's a real good starting point. So try to analyze a lot of music you hear rhythmically, and you'll develop sort of an intuitive sense of what kind of rhythms you have to use in order to make phrases that are cool. Let me play a few more examples, and we'll break them down into just the rhythm. For instance, here's a tune I've written recently. It's a faster tune. It's, the tempo is something like that. One, two, three, four. Rhythmically, it's one, two, three, four. That's a pretty long one, but you can analyze certain things about it that'll help you get that feel. It's there aren't any triplets in it. It's all based off figures that can be divided by four. It's either quarter notes, or eighth notes, or sixteenth notes. Combinations of that. There's no triplets. And from doing that kind of thing, you get a specific kind of feel. Whereas something that's more triplet oriented. It could be something like, let's see, here's one, two, three, four. Which rhythmically would be. More of a swing kind of feel. So just, try to do that to everything you can. Really sort of set out on a quest of breaking things down rhythmically. Analyzing what the heck's going on, and then being able to build it back up. You can even take a rhythm of a song that's somebody else's song, add your own notes, it'll probably sound completely different. This will work real well in just teaching you how to compose and how to phrase. Really, really great tool again for doing that thing where you do rhythm solo. You got to think of a rhythm at that tempo. Maybe. Heck, that Mozart thing would work. That real slow and goofy rhythm at that point, But if you had the right notes, it's gonna sound cool, it gets mean sounding. It's all in the way you add the notes in. But there's always that basic rhythmic structure that if you pay attention to it and analyze it a little bit, will really help out your phrasing a whole lot. Okay, so we talked about rhythm, we talked about phrasing, and through the whole thing I sort of assumed that when I said, and then you add the notes, that you knew what I meant. But just in case that's not entirely clear, here's something that's worked great for me, and hopefully will work good for you, is a lot of stuff based off pentatonic. The reason I use this scale, it works in a lot of different musical styles, and it's real easy to do. And a lot of good notes in it. Give you an example of what the heck I mean. Just your standard pentatonic fingering, an A minor or something. Played straight up and down like that is fairly, sort of exercise scale sounding, it's not fast enough to be terrifying, and it's not, just pentatonic scale, pretty boring. You gotta add the rhythm and the dynamics and all those things. You gotta be able to go, pick a tempo, and suddenly it's music, But to me, that kind of shape works real well because all the notes sound good. It's not like a big seven-note scale, like a major scale, where a lot of the tones aren't as strong. They aren't chord tones. They aren't the root, the third, the fifth, or notes that if you bend them, like right there, I hit the fourth and bend it up to the fifth or the seventh. And bend it up to the root. And that's the cool thing about pentatonic, is everything's either a chord tone or a note where if you bend it up, it becomes a chord tone. So you're almost guaranteed whatever you hit, it's going to sound cool, or it won't sound cool right away until you bend it, but bending so hip that it'll make it sound cool and it'll add to your phrasing. Another thing you can do is starting to add on other notes to give it a little more flavor. And the cool thing about thinking pentatonic and then adding on another note is it saves up that note. It's not like a big, long scale with lots of notes in it where you're always using the notes over and over again, so you get tired of them. This, you save it up, so when you hit that extra note, it really stands out and has a great effect to it. For instance, you know, a simple one is just add the blues note. This is a flat five. In this case, it would be a D sharp or an E flat. I guess an E flat if I said flat five. So a good fingering for that, you know, just your standard pentatonic. Add that note. That kind of thing. Again, played straight through as a scale, it's not that exciting. But if you add it on in a rhythm, single rhythm, let's see. Something like that. Let me do that again, see if I can get a slightly better note choice. Same rhythm. Yeah, something like that. It gives you that little extra flavor. You do the same thing with the Dorian note, which is the major sixth. Which is real cool for bending, too, up to the major or the minor seventh. And that'll sound something like this if you do the full pentatonic scale with the Dorian note added. Something like that. Real cool for phrasing. You know, if you, again, let's do that. Think of a rhythm. You know, I guess a definite unique sound to it. And as opposed to playing a whole Dorian scale up and down, it sounds a lot more musical. It sounds more like a phrase that you know, came from your brain instead of your fingers. Another one is the major third, which I often use after the minor third. In other words, instead of just replacing the minor third with it, I'll go, I kind of do like the root, the minor third, the major third. Gives it a sort of a combination Dorian Mixolydian sound. Real great way of ending a blues phrase, you know, going like, and also has a flavor of the major pentatonic, which of course is the same fingering down a minor third in position. This will also work great if you go between both major pentatonic and minor pentatonic. They complement each other very much if you play it in a bluesy kind of a context. You know, if you what I did there, played major pentatonic first. And then tried to end it with minor pentatonic. So I'll do a couple things where I go between the two positions. It'll be obvious which scale I'm using because I'll either be down here in second position or up here in fifth. So let's try that. You know, that's one of the cool things about that bluesy kind of style is you can get away with going between that minor and major thing, and it sounds really cool. You can even play the same lick. You can take something like, you know, just real simple, you know. There I slid into a C sharp and just did four notes out of major pentatonic, C sharp, E, F sharp, and A. I do that to try and make sure it works. Then I do the same exact thing in minor pentatonic, so it'd be up three frets, which the notes happen to be E, G, A, and C. So you can do the two together. Now that sounds pretty cool to slow tempo, you know. You can also do it pretty quick, you know. Again, the notes, the actual note choice is real simple, right out of pentatonic, but it's the phrasing and the rhythm that makes it interesting, and the dynamics, how hard you hit it, if you're muting the strings. All those things are real easy to overlook if you're doing, you know, lots of metronoming and stuff, but in real music, that's what brings it to life.
I knew that.
Thank you.